gonna do a little something like this. We about ready to start the real show.
Welcome to Nitty Gritty News 2.0. My name is Frank Latin, but you can just call me Nitty. As the host of the show, let me set the table for you. The Nitty Gritty News Show is an effort to engage community residents and generate discussion on a variety of issues. Our goal is to provide factual, unbiased information. Now, we don't profess to know everything under the sun, not at all. But me and my team, we took the time to plan, research, and do the knowledge so that we can provide information that allows viewers to form their own opinions. You see, we actually value opinions around here. You also need to know that we are not affiliated with any special interest group. We have no political affiliation whatsoever and no hidden agenda. So please, don't get upset with me if you disagree with information that's presented on this show. What I would ask is that you contact us, let us know your opinion, and tell us why you disagree. You may be able to give me a different perspective on the issue. That way, we can engage in respectful discourse and move the conversation forward. I'll tell you right now, we plan to have interesting discussions on current events, news updates, as well as some other touchy issues. Now, what we don't need is negativity and hate. So if you're the type of person that just want to go in on somebody just because, then maybe you should just stay behind your keyboard and continue your life as a cyber hater. So, to sum it up, Nitty Gritty News represents community journalism, and we discuss issues from a community perspective, unlike the corporate news outlets that we see every day. We feel like the more the neighborhood residents are aware and doing their own politicking about the issues that affect their communities, the better off we are as a democracy. So, with that being said, today we want to take a look at America's gun culture and discuss the effects of the new concealed carry law here in Illinois. Gwen Pepin will give a report on community health. We also have an interview with KRS-One and news briefs. We will also discuss the Stop Snitching movement and the police code of silence right after this brief message.
The Westside Writing Project is a youth enrichment program that works with area students to cultivate their interests in media and journalism. WWP seeks to partner with area schools and community centers to develop youth media teams that will research, report, and publish news stories on a variety of school and community issues. Students interested in joining our news team will receive exposure, guidance, and support in a variety of media-related activities, including public speaking, interviewing techniques, researching and collecting information, use of video editing software, as well as production and publishing of original content. WWP has after-school, summer, and weekend offerings that include digital media workshops and a broadcast news program. These programs enable students to develop new interests and skills, interact with cutting-edge technology, and collaborate with other students in a team environment. While many schools are forced to deal with a lack of resources and curriculum challenges, WWP serves as a model for positive youth development that employs media and journalism as a means for individual and community transformation. Come explore the wonders of technology and digital media by partnering with the Westside Writing Project. For more information, please visit our website at www.westsidewriting.org. We also invite you to join us on Facebook, Twitter, and YouTube.
Welcome back to Nitty Gritty News 2.0. I'm your host, Frank Latin. Ever since the terrible massacre in Newtown, Connecticut back in December of 2012, the debate over gun control has taken center stage, both nationally and here in Illinois, which recently became the last state in the nation to adopt the concealed carry law, which will take effect next year. So, what does that mean for the city of Chicago, the murder capital, a city already struggling with gun violence? Let's take a look at this next video that discusses the issue.
Americans represent 5% of the world's total population, yet own 50% of the total guns on Earth. There are an estimated 310 million non-military firearms in the United States. This works out to roughly one gun for every man, woman, and child in America. There are more guns in the United States than there are registered vehicles on the roads. In 2010, there were 242 million registered vehicles in the U.S. In 2001, 20,844 people suffered gunshot wounds that required a hospital stay. In 2011, the figure increased to 30,759. It seems that all discussion involving gun control comes back to the Second Amendment of the Constitution. Those who support gun rights often cite it as proof of what this country's founding fathers intended. It includes the language, a well-regulated militia being necessary to the security of a free state, the right of the people to keep and bear arms shall not be infringed. The language has created considerable debate about the amendment's intended scope. In December of 2012, a federal appeals court ruled that the Illinois ban on concealed weapons was unconstitutional and gave the state 180 days to come up with a new law that allows Illinois citizens to carry concealed weapons. In recent years, Chicago has made national as well as international headlines for the ongoing gun violence impacting the city. Chicago, or Chirac as it has been referred to, regained the infamous title as the murder capital of America in 2012 with over 500 murders, the vast majority the result of gun violence. Despite the daily occurrence of gun violence and the impact on the youth, over 550 killed since 2008, it took the massacre at Sandy Hook Elementary School in December of 2012 to ignite the national debate on gun control. In response to the Sandy Hook massacre, President Obama established a new gun violence task force to search for new policy proposals for reducing gun violence. Obama called on Congress to pass legislation that would close the gun show loophole and require universal background checks, limit high-capacity ammunition clips. Despite numerous high-profile mass shootings in 2012, each of Obama's gun control proposals were defeated in Congress, reinforcing the fact that despite numerous recent national tragedies involving gun violence, America, more so than any other nation on earth, continues its love affair with guns. With the new conceal and carry law on the way, which will inevitably lead to more guns on the streets of Chicago, should we expect more gun violence in Chirac? Or as supporters of gun rights suggest, will the new law that allows the residents to protect themselves lead to a drop in gun violence?
Months and months, we've seen talk shows and politicians from Washington, D.C. to Springfield discussing the issue of gun control. What I want to know is, what do neighborhood residents, the people most likely affected by gun violence, have to say? We have my man Mike from Headquarters Barbershop out on Madison and Leamington. Mike, what you have to say about the issue, man?
It could work both ways, but you have to really think about when you allow concealed weapons anywhere in the city of Chicago. This is the reason why this state was the last state to go into the union as far as accepting the laws is because of the murder rate that is here. And even accepting the guns and everything else. So therefore, I think that if we do all that, you know what I'm saying? I think it's going to go up because not only is it just a gun, it's just society, period. It is a violent society.
The violence will increase because people who didn't have guns prior to the law being changed are still going to have the mentality as if they should have theirs because it's going to be more legal people with theirs. And with that being said, Chicago life is a mentality. It always has been since Al Capone. This city is labeled gangster for a reason, and it's not in a good way. I'm from Chicago, and with that being said, the violence can only increase even though we are the last state, which is Illinois, to actually pass and amend this law, meaning we can have concealed weapons.
How can you add more guns to the equation and expect for the gun violence to go down? It was already, Chicago had over 500 murders last year, and those was all illegal weapons. So now you add people with legal weapons, how many killings do you think is going to be now where people are already so feared that they feel they got to defend themselves? So with that, and the murders last year all together just going to equal more murders and more violence in the city.
have any issues you would like to see discussed on this show, contact us at nittygrittynewsshow@gmail.com. Next up, we have a report on community health issues by Gwen Pepin, right after this brief message. It's a well-known fact that we face severe challenges in K-12 education. Not only here in Chicago, where we just witnessed the largest single school closing initiative in U.S. history, but the entire country as well. In today's high-tech global society, Americans will have to compete with workers from around the globe for good jobs. But when you look at test scores, particularly in math and science, the U.S. ranks near the bottom when compared to other industrialized nations. And this is a great concern because most of the new high-paying jobs are technology related. So we're talking engineers, computers analysts, systems analysts, which all require strong math and science backgrounds. We like to think of Chicago as a world-class city. And in some areas, mainly in and around the Loop, this is true, with its first-class museums, theaters, and restaurants. But on the south and west sides of the city, our students are receiving a third-world education. So where does that fit into the new global structure? Nitty Gritty News. Hop. Welcome back to Nitty Gritty News 2.0. I'm your host, Frank Latin. Promoting healthy lifestyles has become a popular trend among local and state governments across the country as they struggle to deal with rising healthcare costs. But how far should we go? Should we ban certain unhealthy products? Or better yet, should we ban certain people from certain products? Let's take a look at this brief video that discusses this issue.
Hi, I'm Gwen Pepin, a reporter for the Nitty Gritty News. Today's health segment revolves around a prevalent issue affecting many residents here in Chicago. Major portions of the city, mainly the south and west sides, have been labeled as food deserts, areas where there are a lack of grocery stores and healthy, affordable food. In fact, U.S. Agriculture Secretary stated that over 400,000 Chicagoans do not have easy access to fresh produce. A large number of city residents are victims of diet-related illnesses such as diabetes and obesity. Here's what Mayor Rahm Emanuel wants to do about it. He, along with 17 other mayors from cities across the country, have submitted a letter to Speaker of the House John Boehner and House Minority Leader Nancy Pelosi, asking lawmakers to consider limiting the use of the SNAP, or Supplemental Nutrition Assistance Program, known as food stamps, to buy sugar-sweetened beverages.
That's right. They want to stop SNAP participants from purchasing pop with their link cards.
However, soda continues to be available in City Hall vending machines. Last year, when asked about limiting the size or sale of soft drinks, the mayor insisted he believed firmly in personal responsibility, according to the Chicago Tribune. This push brings to mind another controversial initiative made by the mayor of another major city who also signed this letter. Mayor Michael Bloomberg of New York aimed for a healthy city by seeking to ban extra-large sodas, but the proposal was shot down. According to the Huffington Post, the ban would not have only affected poor people, as previously thought by many, but all citizens who purchase and drink soda at restaurants and venues. All citizens are affected by bad eating habits, not just those who benefit from SNAP. With the United States leading the world in soda consumption, and Humboldt Park suffering from one of the highest rates of diabetes in the nation, is Emanuel justified in seeking to ban soda purchases with SNAP? I recently interviewed Maggie Nava at the Diabetes Empowerment Center here in Humboldt Park to get her perspective on this issue.
A few years ago, I believe it's about 7 years ago, Cyanide did a study, and they did screenings, and they found out that there was about, I believe, 24% of people in Humboldt Park that had diabetes or were about to have diabetes. They were pre-diabetic, yeah. So it's a really high number compared to the rest of the states and the area here in Chicago. And it was also noted that it had the highest in the nation. Just Humboldt Park itself had the highest diabetes rate.
Rahm Emanuel and like 20 other mayors from major cities are behind this push to not allow SNAP people who benefit from SNAP to purchase soda.
What do you feel about that? Do you think it can improve the eating habits of?
Oh, no. I completely disagree with that because it's basically telling us what, again, it goes back to what we can and can't do. Yeah. And if somebody tells you you can't do something, you're going to want it. You want to do it more. And again, I think that issue is going it around the wrong way. We need to educate people, not take away stuff from them. We need to tell them this is why we're doing this or why we want to do this. And again, it's all about education. If we could start with educating people on healthier eating, then we hope that people make better decisions. And unfortunately, people who benefit from SNAP already have stressors in their lives and they don't need another one. Yeah, I definitely feel like they're bullying them.
Thanks for that interesting report, Gwen. But personally, I can see where these mayors are coming from with this initiative, especially since we know that obesity leads to a number of health-related illnesses such as heart disease, diabetes, and cancer. So I see it as a health-conscious decision since we know that low-income residents suffer disproportionately from these illnesses due to poor dieting.
Well, I feel like this whole country is really suffering from poor eating habits and cancer and diabetes and obesity. But more specifically, areas in Chicago are food deserts, and these same people who are purchasing junk food with SNAP don't have access to healthy foods. They don't have grocery stores in their neighborhoods, so it's harder for them to eat healthy.
You know, Gwen, another point I want to make, and this is not about disrespecting anyone, but anyone who has ever shopped at a corner store in a neighborhood or a gas station knows that SNAP is being used to purchase a lot of junk food. And I know people feel they have a right to eat whatever they want. I understand that. But if you're receiving public assistance, the taxpayer is paying for those purchases. And as a taxpayer, I'm not sure if I want my tax dollars to go towards multiple bags of chips and soda.
Well, I feel that instead of taking away their right to purchase whatever they want at the grocery store, we should focus on educating these communities, teaching them how to eat and live better and healthier.
I agree with everything you just said. And I think the objective is to persuade public opinion to adopt a healthier lifestyle. Because, you know, once these people get sick, guess who pays the healthcare costs for these health-related illnesses? It's the taxpayer. And we're talking billions of dollars from average taxpayers like me and you. We're going to be responsible for footing the bill for these health care costs. So, you know, it's in everybody's interest that we adopt a healthier lifestyle and a healthy campaign. But I agree with everything you just said. You know, thank you again for that excellent report, Gwen.
Thank you. See you next time. Audience, what is your opinion on this push? Is it overbearing or proactive? I'm Gwen Pepin with the Nitty Gritty News. See you next time.
The number of people incarcerated in this country has exploded since President Reagan began the process of privatizing the prison system back in the 80s. Now you got to think about it. You're talking about for-profit companies now in charge of running the prisons. So the recent decision by the Attorney General to reform the drug sentencing in this country, that's a major game changer. And you already know there's going to be people lining up on the other side to oppose it. So it's like crime is down, but prisons are popping up all over like franchises, and they primarily being filled with nonviolent street-level drug offenders and mostly minority men. So it's not surprising that the U.S. leads the world in incarceration rates. And according to Attorney General, we spent $80 billion in 2000 alone on incarceration. $80 billion. That's crazy, man. So programs are being cut, services are being cut, schools are closing, but prisons are being built. But we can't find that same money to educate these people. And believe it or not, this is exactly the way some people want it. Nitty Gritty News. Holla. Welcome back to Nitty Gritty News 2.0. I'm here with a longtime friend of mine, Mark Davis. Me and Mark have always shared a similar taste in music, so I want to have this brief discussion with him. But first, you know, Mark has traveled abroad extensively as a DJ and as an artist. Matter of fact, Mark, why don't you kind of talk about your experience overseas and travels?
Well, I first went overseas and went abroad to London, UK, for the Essential Festival at Finsbury Park back in 1996. And I went over there with De La Soul, Kool Keith from the Ultramagnetics, Brand Nubian, DJ Spin from Chicago, Lee Scratch Perry. I was actually performing as well. And it was just a big phenomenal change in my life when I went over there and see how the Europeans embraced black music and extensively, you know, a lot of the artists are still able from the golden era of music, still able to go out there and do shows, constantly working and, you know, performing to the kids out there.
And you know, we've talked about this over the years because you've told me this several times about how a lot of those throwback artists from the late 80s and early 90s, although, you know, you don't really see them much over here today, but you explained to me how, you know, they're still viable and still drawing crowds overseas, right?
Yeah, definitely. Most of the artists, especially in the, you know, even with the hip hop, from Big Daddy Kane to Kool G Rap, MC Shan, KRS-One, they all still go over there and perform and do shows constantly because they still have a catalog of music, and so their music never dies down. It just continues to go on, you know, repeat itself after, you know, generation to generation, still can appreciate them.
And briefly, what do you think is the difference in, like, in the U.S., you know, those artists, for a lot of people who listen to rap, they think of those artists as old school, play it out, like, you know, it's over for those artists, whereas you got today's artists. Can you kind of briefly touch on, like, you know, what's keeping those artists still viable overseas?
Well, a lot of them put out classic albums, you know, and you know, their fathers and their brothers and stuff have educated them on the music, and that sound is just, it's just a respect for that particular sound, especially in the golden era with the samples and the break beats and, you know, rhyming and have something to say on you know, over beats. You know, they're just more into that. And, you know, it's just a younger generation. And, you know, Wu-Tang, all those groups are still, you know, doing well. They go all over from London to all through Scandinavia. You name it, they go over there and do shows.
And speaking of KRS-One, we're going to get into it briefly, but you interviewed Chris. Right now, we want to go into that brief interview from Mark Davis with KRS-One. Check this out.
Now, I just got to, it's kind of, I want you to elaborate on something for me. I'm going to drop something. Mastermind Productions, Pat Miller, Keyboard Money Mike,
yes.
Sed G, Scott LaRock, SB12, Ultramagnetic MCs.
Yes. Yes.
And a relationship with Boogie Down Productions. I ain't waited 15 years plus to ask you that.
Damn. But here's
real
the relationship.
Talk.
On 166th Street in Boston Road in the Bronx, I was in a homeless shelter there. Scott LaRock was the social worker at the shelter, and I was one of the clients. There was another guy named Funkmaster, the original Funkmaster from a graffiti crew called the Rascals. And Funkmaster was a security guard at the shelter. Funkmaster heard me and Just Ice in the bathroom of the shelter beating on the wall. And Just Ice was doing LaToya back then on the wall. We used to go, I used to do the beat, and he used to be like, LaToya. LaToya. So I used to do the beat, and he used to do the LaToya. So Funkmaster heard it and said, yo, there's a dude in the projects named Sed G, and he got this new machine, a new sampler. And you got to go check him. So I went over there. Now, here's the deal. I'm coming out the shelter. I'm dirty. I stink. My clothes is like, I'm out the shelter. They didn't judge me. I'll never forget this about Sed G, okay? When I met Sed G, he was chilling. He was fresh from head to toe. He was eating every day. I walked in his house. I'm the homeless guy. I walk in. First thing, his mom sat me down. His mom sat me down and put a plate of food in front of me. I didn't ask for the food or nothing, but I guess they assumed. She put the mac and cheese out with the same. It just was like out of a playbook, like an African-American recipe book. You know, mac and cheese, collard greens, fried fish, candied. It was like a Thanksgiving dinner. I sat down. Now, I'm from the shelter. Everything's plastic and styrofoam. This is the first time in like nine, maybe even a year, that I see a ceramic plate and a steel fork. And I never forget, my hand couldn't adjust to the fork. I couldn't pick the fork up because it was a steel fork or silver or whatever it was. But I was so used to little plastic forks and styrofoam like for about a year. So I'm sitting in said G house. His mom's come lay out the food. I almost bit the plate. Dude, I was like, yo, I scoffed that down. Anything said G said at that moment, if he said, yo, go up the block and kill that dude, I was out. Yeah. Sure, if he said, yo, I need you to do anything he said at that moment, I was with it. Luckily, he said, yo, spit your rhyme. No problem. I start lacing him. Start giving him stuff about nuclear war and the universe and Malcolm X. And he was like, yo, ain't nobody rhyming like that. I didn't know. These are my rhymes. This is how I get down. So Sed G was like, yo, you got to, come on, I got to record you tomorrow. I came back the next day. I'm in his room. This time now he brings like 5-6 other MCs. Cool Keith is like 11 years old. Cool Keith is like, well, he's a little guy running around listening to us rock. Like, this is just amazing, like who Cool Keith is now. But that then, Cool Keith was real young, Sed G, and his brother Pat, rest in peace. So these five MCs are in there, and they have the all rhymes. You know, this, you know, like Run DMC, you know, I'm D, he's Run, I'm J, he's D, we gonna rock this beat, da 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 da. He was going like that. So I'm coming with, that's all single, no more, no less. That's how I was going. I'm like doing 16, but I ain't never heard that. You know, this is before poetry was, that's before Eric B and Rock, this is before all the styles changed. It was all Run DMC style. So Sed G caught me, he said, yo, let's make demos together. So technically, I'm the first member of Ultra Magnetic. Right. Technically, right. It could have easily. If Sed G said, "Nah, I don't want you to go with Scott LaRock. You should be here." I'd be like, "I'm sorry, Scott. I'm here with Sed G. This is what I was focused on, Sed G, and it wasn't about the music. It was about the food. It was about the food and the warm plate." And to be in a room, like, outside the shelter, I was like, I can live here forever. I'm homeless. Dude invited me in his bedroom. You know what I'm saying? I mean, I know this might not mean anything to anybody, but when you homeless and somebody invites you in their house and you living in the street, I was like, love, dude, what forever, whatever.
So that's it. Nitty Gritty News, that's the end of our show. Now I need to know if there's anybody out there that's feeling the demonstration. Anybody want to get down with us, just hit us up at our contact info. Now, I know some people out there like, Needy, who told you you could? Nah, I didn't ask your permission. I didn't have to ask your alderman, your state rep, your preacher. Nah, we did it on our own. Community journalism. Now, go run, tell that. Nitty Gritty News. Holla.